It always kind of amazes me. Yesterday when we were up at the men's meeting, Mike Dean talked about how all his elders are preaching elders. And Kit was giving me the look, you know, like, you guys need to step in here, you know. They're all preaching elders. What about you guys? And so guess what? I get an opportunity without preparing at all to have something. So it always amazes me how God works in certain instances. So if it isn't real good, you'll know why. I had really nothing prepared other than something I'd been reading, and it kind of struck me. So that's what I'm going to share with you, but it's going to be probably pretty short. Oh yeah, children's church. They might be the only ones who clap and think it's good, though. Children's church. You're going to? Oh, good. We'll all be out there pretty quick, maybe. So, well, you know, I've had this little, you know, it's a Bible promises for life. And it, what struck me on this was how many promises God has made to us in the Bible. If you really get to looking, it fills a tremendous amount. And there is a promise for almost every conceivable thing you'll run into in your life. He has granted us a promise upon him. Well, we'll get into that a little bit, but just promises for everything they'll help us with. So that's kind of what I'm going to preach on today. If you look in here, don't go by this, because I don't know what that was. One thing I wanted to share, the baptistry is filled. Because Kit had an inclination that something was going to happen to him. Now, what that meant, I don't know. But he thought he needed to have that baptistry filled. So, isn't it amazing? God works through many different avenues. So, whatever it might be, will be. So, I'm going to go ahead here. I'm going to just start with reading a little bit here. There is a wonderful, rich hymn that should be the anthem of every Christmas. The refrain goes like this. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Well, you know, I had to have quite a prayer session right before this, so I went back to the first. I'm glad I got through that part anyway. Thank you for that. But isn't that such a great thing? It just tells us we're standing on the promises of God for a lot of things, strength to make it through so many trials in our lives. And when I was in with Kit and his family for prayer right before this, they were standing on those promises very greatly. They were clinging to them, you could tell. And they knew that God was with them and with his grandmother. So, what an example it was for me to go in there. It just seems like everything ties together to me in a lot of ways that we don't understand. This is the kind of song you sing at the top of your lungs when you're faced with an eviction notice or a pink slip. When you get that unexpected phone call or unwanted medical result, Russell Carter's song is rooted in the encouraging promises from God's word that reminds us the earth and the sky will wear out and fade away before one word I speak loses its power or fails to accomplish its purposes. Matthew 24:35. If that is one of the greatest promises I think I ever read, we know for certain that this will last beyond anything we can ever imagine. It will be with us forever. What a wonderful promise, one of many that God has spoken over our life. There are hundreds of similar guarantees from God's word for every one of your needs. From fears to forgiveness, provision to protection, security, and God's ultimate salvation through his son. These promises don't change and are always true. They are for all people, for all time, because they reflect the character of God and His ultimate purpose, the all-embracing blessing and flourishing of the world in and through Jesus Christ. You know, when you read certain scripture, it seems to open up your very being. Everything that you have in you is touched in some ways when you read certain scripture. That is one of the greatest promises that God has given us, is His word is true and His word is always there. It will give us everything we need to go on through life. And when I read these particular words through Jesus Christ, it reinforced to me more than anything why we are here, why we serve who is in Christ, why we have accepted Him as our Lord and Savior. In the center of all God promises is the Hebrew word berith, the word for covenant. It's one of the Bible's most important themes and critical for unlocking numerous verses that remind us of what our Heavenly Father has personally guaranteed. Covenant is different from contract, because the intent is to form a solidify a relationship. See, God didn't want a contract with us. He wants that personal relationship with each and every person here. He wants to know us in a way that, as you know your wife, as you know your child, your husband, your grandparent or your grandmother, that's what He wants from us. He wants to know everything about you. When I thought about that, I thought, oh boy, that's scary. I don't want Him knowing everything about me. There's things I'd like to keep hidden. Some of the things I do, some of the things I think in my mind. And yet, it says right here that God knows every one of my thoughts. Do I really think I can keep those things hidden from Him? Sometimes it's an eye-opener to really study something in the Bible and have it hit you there. Things we think and accept as truth are not that way at all. God jolts us sometimes into awakening. At the heart of the covenant is a relationship between God and people, a relationship characterized by faithfulness and loyal love. While people are anything but faithful, promises of the Bible are guaranteed because that the God who created this bread has hessed. The English Bible often translate hessed as loving kindness, a steadfast love. And you see, that's where God's love is so much different than mine. It never falters, it never varies. His love is constant, it is always there. It's always around me, surrounding me. Everything I need. Sometimes as troubles overtake us, such as maybe someone we love who's about to pass away, that is so evident when you find the peace that can only come from having a Father in heaven. We cannot give that peace to anyone here. We try with everything we have, but there's a peace that comes from God that is beyond our understanding. And that is the peace that we have as Christians and those who have accepted Jesus our Lord and Savior. English Bibles often treat this as a loving kindness or steadfast love. These definitions really don't capture the nature of this love. Hebrew word, however, at the center of the character of God, isn't just loving kindness, but a fierce, faithful, unconventional loyalty. A loyalty to us. Isn't that an amazing thing that God would have that loyalty to a people who abandons Him, who continually sins, hurts Him in every way that there is, and yet His loyalty is beyond anything we can even comprehend. He is there always and will be. Man, God is something that is beyond our comprehension at times. But He is our. passage from the book of Jonah captures best the true character of God, who is a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity for two. This refrain is repeated through the Hebrew scriptures to remind us that people and us today, that God is loyal to the relationship he formed. God is the one who formed that relationship. He's the one who came forward and did this for us. All we need to do is step forward into that relationship. Isn't that a wonderful thing to know, that it's always there, it's always open? He wants us to be in that relationship with him, to allow him to be the loving Father that only he can be, to give us all we need and more. The glue that binds all biblical covenants together is God's recreation purpose of individual divine blessing. With each of the Bible's covenants, from Noah to Abraham, the kings to Israel, and to the church, God has had one ultimate unifying goal: to restore this broken world to the way he originally envisioned it in the beginning, before the fall. Do you think we'll be around to see that, to know it is back to what it was before the fall? We will, but maybe not here upon this earth. What a glorious thought to behold the creation that was meant to be, that God created in the beginning for us, and that we are the ones who are strong, not him. It's going to be something special for each and every one of us to be able to participate in that, to be there. To just, you know, somebody once asked me what's it going to be like in heaven. And I said, well, what do you think? And they said that. I said, that's true. What do you think? I said, well, and they said, I think that's true too. I think there are so many different views on what heaven is, and yet we all have one thing in common. It's going to be the most wonderful thing we can imagine. We are going to be with God. That's all that counts. That ultimate goal is that you should keep in mind as you explore everything this guide for your life. All God's promises are founded upon God's ultimate plan, the one God requiring obedience and loyalty from his special people. Another thing, we are his special people. Sometimes we forget that how special we truly are. But yet, would have God sent his son if we weren't that special? Would God wait as long as he does for all of us to accept him? I've often wondered, would I have the patience to wait? But yet he does not want one soul to be lost. He wants each and every one of us to know that word, to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. He has waited how long? Well beyond anything I can comprehend. But yet he continues to have the patience that only God has. All God's promises are found upon his ultimate plan, the one God requiring obedience and loyalty to his special people, who are saved through this promise, saved through his promised Savior, or forgiven of their sins in order to be recreated anew. What this means is that the gospel, God's story of rescue and recreation through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, is at the heart of all God's promises. All God's divine promises have their fulfillment in what the Father did and through his Son on the cross, signing a new covenant in his blood. Again, it all comes back to our Lord and our Savior, who came down here and died upon that cross. That's why we celebrate each Sunday at the time when we take communion. This was going to be a communion meditation for me in time. Probably next time I was up here, actually. So, but having read it, having studied quite a little bit, I thought that it would give us an an uplift in our lives. It gives us something to cling to help us to see and understand more. All the promises in God's holy book are meant for us. He made those promises and will never break a single one of them. He will be with us forever. He will always help us through all things. And I just hope that each and every one of you call on Him to help you through those times of trouble. But not only trouble, but when you have the good times, to call upon Him also. Give, just share the joy with Him. Because I know God wants that as much as He does our prayers for our needs and everything else. So just always remember, God wants both sides of our prayers. So He likes to have joy in His life also, in His time. You know, I want to do it a little different. I really feel that we need to come together as a body and pray for Kit and his family. They are going through a very troubling time for them at this time. And not being with her, I think, is the hardest part of this whole situation for all of them. I know that Tim is going to be going back there this coming week. We're going to make sure that they get there. I think we as a body need to find out how we can help in any way and be willing to step forward in whatever it takes to do this for them. It means a great deal to them. I would like us to come together as a body and join hands and just pray for our minister and his family. There's a time when a prayer can lift up so much and give so much.